Our New Testament lesson from today comes from Acts 9, 1 through 20. Let us listen to the word of God. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found anyone who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with Saul stood speechless because they heard the voice, but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could not see anything. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight and neither ate nor drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias?" He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight. And in the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen a vision of a man named Ananias come in and lay hands on him so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem, and here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before the Gentiles and kings, and before the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house and laid hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on your way here, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately, something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days, he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is the Son of God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This morning's New Testament lesson is about a conversion. It's a famous, well-known conversion, at least for those of us who are Christians and well-versed in Scripture. It's the conversion of Paul, or as he was still known at the time of this event, Saul. Now, one of the things you have to say about Paul is that he was a man of great faith. Before the New Testament lesson, he's a man of deep Jewish faith. After this New Testament lesson event, he is a man of deep Christian faith. But that's not the only conversion that Paul experiences here from Judaism to Christianity. It's also a conversion from an arrogant, blind faith to a mature, seeing faith. Faith that is blind and arrogant listens only selectively to the truth. It doesn't listen to the whole truth. And that was Saul. Saul was a very religious individual. He was described as blameless in the eyes of the law of Moses. In other words, Saul was passionate about God, and he listened to the law and the tradition, and that's a good thing. And he was also a Pharisee among Pharisees, very passionate about the faith of his fathers and absolutely convinced that he was doing the will of God. He was passionate for God. Listen to the community of faith. And that's a good thing. And Saul was well-educated, trained at the feet of Gamaliel, one of the leaders of the rabbis of that day. And it's good to listen to the voice of teachers. Unfortunately, of all the voices he's listening to, there's one voice that is missing, and that's the voice of Jesus Christ. Blind, arrogant faith refuses to listen to the whole Word of God. And I bet you are aware of people like that in your life. People who, when confronted with a challenge in their faith, will approach it as something like green eggs, refusing to eat green eggs and ham, refusing to listen to a part of the Word of God they haven't embraced before. I've got a college buddy who has no tattoos on his body because the Old Testament book of Leviticus speaks against it. Now, I don't have any tattoos either, but because I'm chicken. He does not eat lobster because, again, the Old Testament book of Leviticus says that's unclean. I don't eat lobster because it's too expensive. But my buddy, you know, he's not generous. He would never give to someone less fortunate. He's very judgmental. And he's probably the most racist person that I know. And yet, he is devoted to his faith, or his portion of his faith. He hasn't heard the whole Word of God. He hasn't heard some of the most important words of God. And his faith is blind and arrogant. It needs to grow and mature. Another thing about this blind faith is it's got a lot of passion, but no compassion. A good example in this age is the Islamic extremists who kidnap people, mostly innocent civilians. They hold them hostages. In many cases, they put them to death in horrific ways. And yet they speak about following the will of God. It's so difficult to read about these people in the newspapers. And we just shake our heads in confusion and wonder, how can people who claim to be a people of God go out and do so much hate? It's because their faith is blind and arrogant. It has passion, but no compassion. It's missing so much that a true, seeing, mature faith would have. And Saul was a lot like that. He was on fire for God. He was filled with passion. And yet he had so much missing in that early faith of his. Compassion, he was without it. Love, understanding. These are things you see in Saul later on when he's called Paul. At the stoning of St. Peter, the first martyr of the church, he was there. And as our New Testament lesson begins, he's out trying to round up all the Christians, and he's going to make them prisoners. He's an extremist. And we're not going around killing people, but we have to admit that sometimes our faith is lacking in the compassion and the understanding and the love that Christ would have our faith to have. If our faith is to mature and grow, we need not only passion, we need also compassion. We need to focus on love and understanding. While Saul is on his road to Damascus, he encounters Christ. And one of the other things he learns about faith that is blind and arrogant is that it is a disappointment to God. Our New Testament lesson put it this way. As he neared Damascus, that is Saul or Paul, as he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice say to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" "Who are you, Lord?" Saul asked. "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting." When I hear the voice of God, I sure would like to hear the voice say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Last thing I want to hear is, "Maynard, Maynard, why are you persecuting me? What are you thinking?" But that's what Saul heard. And the news that the Lord was disappointed in what he was doing. As passionate as it might have been, he was disappointed in Saul. It's a dramatic moment. Saul, Paul thinks Jesus is dead, and here he is talking to Jesus, the risen Lord. And Paul is trying to gather up all the people who believe in Jesus and punish them, and here he is beginning to believe in Jesus himself. Paul is a man who had a blind faith, and now he's literally struck blind by the light of God. And everything changes here for Paul. As much as anything, what changes is that his faith turns from being an arrogant faith to becoming a mature faith that is growing and no longer blind. True faith has open ears and open eyes to see and hear the truth of Christ. It's interesting that Paul has been willing to listen to all sorts of sources except Jesus himself. He's listened to the law of the Lord, which he dearly and sincerely loved, but that wasn't enough. He listened to his teachers, which is good, but it's not enough. He listened to the traditions of his faith, which is good, but not enough. It's never enough to listen to all of the voices around you, but not to listen to Jesus himself. But God eventually does not give Paul any choice. God knocks Paul off of his high horse, literally and figuratively, and Paul is forced to listen to the words of Jesus Christ. Now, when we listen to Jesus, what do we hear? Do we hear arrogance? No. Do we hear hatred? No. Do we hear prejudice? No. What do we hear? We hear things like, love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, and your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. That's what we hear when we listen to the voice of Jesus. We hear the voice of Jesus say things like, love your enemy. Your sins are forgiven. Forgive other people. Peace be with you. Arrogant faith just listens to some of these things, if at all. True faith that sees, listens to these words, and struggles with them. They're not easy. Love your enemy? It's a hard thing. Love your neighbor? That's hard for some of us. There's a story of Paul that illustrates how his faith so greatly matured. Years after this conversion experience, Paul is on a mission trip to Athens, Greece, and he looks around and sees all these temples to false gods. Now, the old Paul, with his blind and arrogant faith, would have stormed in, called the Greeks idol worshipers, probably would have torn down a statue or two, probably would have been arrested for something like that. But his eyes are now open with a true faith and a maturing, growing faith, and he looks around and he doesn't see the false gods as much as he sees that the Greeks are spiritually hungry. They're in search of God and truth. And so in Acts chapter 17, Paul speaks to the Greeks and says, men of Athens, I see that in every way you're very spiritual. For as I walked around and looked around at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with the inscription, to an unknown God. Now let me tell you about the unknown God that you've wondered about. It's an opening to share the gospel in a way that has humility and lacks the arrogance that the old Saul would have had. It's an amazing transformation or conversion for Paul. He's able to see the bigger picture and approach these people without the old arrogance. He communicates the truth of God on their level. And he sees that they may be worshiping false gods, but more than that, they are seeking God. And that's the thing about faith, or it should be. It grows, it changes, it never stops growing and changing. As people of faith, we can never ever say, I have arrived, gotten to the point where I know about the faith completely. I've got it. We're always on a journey. And along the way, we're going to have moments of growth. if we're open to it. And some of them are going to be gentle, slow moments of growth, and some are going to be shocking, dramatic, instantaneous growth, like the road to Damascus. And if we're doing this journey correctly, we'll see more and more, and we'll be less and less one who has a blind faith. Along the way, did you notice that in this New Testament lesson, early Christians were at that time referred to as belonging to the way. The way, not the destination, but the way. And we're all on a journey along the way. And our faith is meant to grow and to change and mature. And to even be willing to listen to a new teaching that we may have rejected before. You see the banner, Michaela? She was baptized at the early service, in case you are wondering that maybe I forgot a baptism today. This is one time that the 8:30 service got to see the baptism. Usually they're here. And Michaela's a baby, an infant. And I'm sorry you missed this. She was such a beautiful child. But you've seen baptisms here, and you know that, you know, I'll take the child and walk up and down the aisle, and I'll introduce the child. And I'll introduce the child as the newest member of our church. But, of course, Michaela or the babies, they don't know what's happening. They don't care. They're not thinking of anything. And it's our responsibility to nurture the child in the faith. And if we do our jobs right, that child will never know a time when Christ was not part of her life. And someday that child and all the other children we've baptized will stand up here and confirm his or her faith and take responsibility for that. But the child doesn't have to wait for the love of God in our church. We baptize infants, and we don't wait for that. But baptism's not the end. It's the beginning of the Christian experience. And so many of us have become Christians, and we're like Saul. We've stagnated. We're not open to new teachings, new understanding, new opportunities for love and service. We're not being challenged. We're stuck. And we're saying, I don't like green eggs and ham. I don't like the idea of loving my enemy. I don't like the idea of this or that. My friends, our faith is meant to mature. We're supposed to be people of the way. So let's enjoy the journey and don't stop growing. And now unto God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be ascribed all might, power, dominion, and glory today and forever. Amen.